They agree about peace, but not about Germany. He tells America he needs time for his reforms. Life's much easier now Mrs. Reagan isn't there. French vets say they may, just may, back British beef. And schools must save so a teacher will go. Good evening. President Gorbachev and President Bush got together in Washington today. The signs were they hit it off and are doing their best for some kind of agreement. Mr. Gorbachev called for an irreversible period of peace. Mr. Bush promised an end to decades of division and discord. It was announced tonight that they'll sign a number of agreements tomorrow, which are likely to include a deal on cutting chemical weapons and a preliminary accord on reducing long-range nuclear missiles. For the latest, our Washington correspondent, Alastair Stewart.
Despite the heady ambition of creating a new and peaceful world order, Alastair, both presidents struck a note of realism at the beginning of this summit. They had come to do serious business, they said, and to take decisive steps toward reducing the numbers of the most dangerous weapons. But, as George Bush put it, they couldn't hope to solve all of the world's problems at one summit. And certainly, an acceptable security system for Germany still eludes them. And there's no prospect of an answer yet to the Baltics crisis, which would leave those countries no longer feeling threatened by the Soviet Union. Nevertheless, the first round of talks are said to have gone very well. They're said to have been upbeat and exhilarating.
In sight and sound, it is a superpower summit like those that have gone before. White House ceremonial is still worthy of history in the making. But both nations have lost some of their supremacy since Mr. Gorbachev was last here in 1987. Even the Soviet Union's claim to be a superpower is in question today, and Mr. Bush can't dictate the West's agenda as his predecessor did. Events in Europe, not planning in Washington, have decided the focus for this meeting. Mr. Bush sees it as an occasion for business, not gesture.
Over the next 4 days, we're not going to solve all of the world's problems. We won't resolve all of the outstanding issues that divide us, but we can and will take significant steps toward a new relationship.
Mr. President, do you think we're settling the differences on Germany?
And business began with a meeting that covered the whole range of East-West issues, including Lithuania and NATO membership for a united Germany. They didn't go into detail, this was groundwork, not negotiation, but they parted for lunch, happy in the knowledge that their officials had made enough detailed progress to produce a range of agreements on chemical weapons, nuclear testing, and at least in principle on strategic nuclear weapons for signing tomorrow.
The President this morning was in a thoughtful, upbeat, and reflective mood. He's eager to hear President Gorbachev's views, to get a better understanding of the Soviet perspective on European issues. This is a summit to anticipate, not to dictate.
Gathered at the Soviet embassy for lunch, a group of writers, thinkers, and film stars picked for the privilege of hearing Mr. Gorbachev give the sort of thoughtful overview he'd just given the president. No doubt about his commitment to improving U.S.-Soviet relations.
Being two major powerful nations at this very crucial stage in the life of our civilization when we are involved in deep changes, we have to be together.
And despite the gravity of the Soviet Union's economic crisis, he was able to make light of the accusation that he hasn't gone far enough in his economic reforms.
It was said that it's difficult to be half pregnant with introducing a market economy. I agree, but at any rate, one has to wait 9 months before a child is born.
Returning to the White House a short time ago for his second round of talks, Mr. Gorbachev echoed the cautious words of George Bush this morning, hinting that this summit won't resolve all the issues that divide them.
I would say that we have a good degree of mutual understanding with the president.
Даже если мы и приходим к разным выводам,
even if sometimes we draw differing conclusions?
The news that several arms control agreements are going to be signed here comes as no surprise. But by getting that out of the way early, the two leaders have left themselves plenty of time to discuss the really contentious issues, particularly the future of Germany. Edward Sturton, News at 10, Washington.
There was much talk of a peaceful Europe and a new era of cooperation, but both men avoided the detail of their fundamental differences over the future of Germany. Put simply, Mr. Bush believes that a united Germany in NATO would be a force for peace and stability. Mr. Gorbachev believes that it would destabilize the balance of power within Europe, and that the prospect of a united Germany in NATO generates fear within the Soviet Union. The evidence suggests that he may have read the mood of his people accurately.
A year ago, Russian tanks began the military withdrawal from Eastern Europe. Soviet military commanders had little choice and fought hard to put a brave face on so serious a political and strategic reversal. By early this month, Gorbachev, here at a military parade in Moscow, was grappling with a far graver crisis. The West was now demanding a reunited Germany become part of NATO. For him, like for almost all Russians, that is, for strategic and historical reasons, unacceptable.
The new generation remembers the stories of the old generation, what had happened, and this memory will exist. And certainly, no government can ignore this memory and should take care that history, in this bad sense, should never repeat.
It still remains unclear what will happen after reunification to the East German army. Will it be absorbed into NATO or disbanded? The two Germanys have traditionally been the place where NATO has confronted the Warsaw Pact. East Germany has 168,000 troops, a third the number of West Germany. It has 250 combat aircraft, less than half that of its neighbor, and its total of just over 2,500 tanks is half the West German total. But Moscow's worry is that a united Germany inside NATO would take over the East German armed forces, posing a powerful new threat to the weakened Warsaw Pact. Analysts agree on one thing.
Germany joining the NATO will shift the balance in favor of the West.
Etched in the memory of every elderly Russian is the experience of the Second World War. From their bitter fight with the Nazis comes an enduring suspicion of German intentions. For the Soviet leadership, accepting that a reunified Germany should become part of NATO would be a massive strategic concession. And the unpopularity of the move would simply compound Gorbachev's problems at home. Robert Moore, News at 10, Moscow.
In his opening remarks, Mr. Bush paid a special welcome to the Soviet president's wife, Raisa. Both she and Mrs. Barbara Bush have their own program of activities, whilst their husbands deal with the main business of the summit. There's a lot going on in Washington, beyond the White House and the offices of the State Department. Some of it they will see and enjoy, some of it they'll miss, which may come as something of a relief.
The two have met before, and the relationship is a warm one, underscored today by an almost gushing welcome from Mr. Bush.
Mr. President, you brought us a beautiful day, and you brought back Mrs. Gorbachev that brings joy to all of our hearts.
Even during the long official welcome in blistering Washington heat, the two had started their discussions. Later, after they'd taken tea in the White House together, Mrs. Bush said she found Raisa to be warm, knowledgeable, and beautiful. All this is quite a contrast from the days of Mrs. Reagan, whose intense dislike of Russia's First Lady was all too obvious. As a pair, they could have restarted the Cold War at a glance. But these are new times. The guests at today's Russian embassy lunch were practically lining up to offer her praise.
I would like to drink Raisa Maxima and what she is doing to bring women in her country into perestroika and the new world of the 90s. Raisa Maxima.
They couldn't hear the few voices of dissent. The usual Washington demonstrations have been rather low-key. Democracy for Vietnam here, a lone man in a gas mask. Drums for Peace by the Hare Krishna. Back at the White House, it seems that even the Bush's dog Millie, known here as the first dog, has fallen under Mrs. Gorbachev's spell. This important new development in superpower relations even prompted a White House official statement. It says, Mrs. Gorbachev and the first dog, Millie, have bonded. And the spokesman went on to say, and I quote, Millie quivered with pleasure whenever Mrs. Gorbachev spoke to her. Ken Rees, News at 10 at the White House.
Later tonight, President and Mrs. Gorbachev will leave the Soviet embassy to travel to the White House for a state dinner. The Soviet embassy is on Sakharov Street, named after the late Soviet dissident in the days when President Reagan referred to the Soviet Union as the evil empire. Well, today, George Bush, in the presence of Mr. Gorbachev, quoted Sakharov, saying, peace and progress are inseparable from political freedom. Mr. Gorbachev didn't appear to disagree. How much things have changed in such a short time. From Washington, it's back to London.
Well, here there are signs that France may be preparing to lift its ban on British beef. Ministry of Agriculture officials believe they've convinced a team of French experts that there is no danger from BSE, mad cow disease. Earlier, British farmers had urged the government to sue France over the damage the beef ban had caused their industry.
These French veterinary surgeons could well decide the future of British beef exports to France. They came here to talk about the problems of BSE so they can report back to their agriculture minister. And after a three-hour meeting, all sides were guardedly optimistic.
This discussion was technical discussion, and we have discussed about a lot of technical question, and I cannot say more about that.
But you said it's a fruitful meeting.
Fruitful meeting.
After the explanation that we have has been given today, we hope that the ban could be withdrawn.
Do you believe that all of the French questions that they had at this meeting have been satisfactorily answered by the British?
I think so.
They indicated towards the end of the meeting that they were also content with our control arrangements. They quite clearly in France have a difficulty with public perception with British beef in the same way as we have here. And I hope that we have convinced them, first of all, that British beef is safe. And indeed, if they were, and I hope they will, lift their import ban on calves and on beef, this will convince the consumer, both in France and also in the UK as well, that British beef is safe to eat.
Today, the French agriculture minister was telling young farmers that his decision to ban British beef imports was to stop worry and panic. And he won't decide what to do next till his veterinary team gets home. So in effect, he's defied the Common Market Commission, which asked France to lift the ban immediately.
I do hope in the not-too-distant future that wiser counsel will prevail and that we will be back to normality because, as I said, there is no justification for this action.
And while there's just home-produced beef on supermarket shelves in Paris, a British minister is there claiming the French should have done their homework before imposing a ban.
We could have made it very clear, as we have done, that there isn't an iota of evidence to suggest that this disease is transmissible to human beings. And so there's no justification in any event for any action of this sort. But of course it should be looked at properly by the scientific experts first before any knee-jerk reaction of this sort takes place.
3 months ago, the European Community banned the export of live cattle over 6 months old from Britain to all other common market countries. West Germany goes further. It will only import boneless British beef carcasses. This week, Austria stopped importing British beef. Now the French have imposed a similar ban. But the French market is vital, accounting for half of our beef exports.
It takes about 5% of our beef output, and the total market is worth between £180 and £190 million a year, so it is very significant.
Though Britain is highly suspicious of the French motives in the affair, perhaps tonight their officials have been reassured, though farmers here will be anxiously awaiting the final decision from Paris.
The BSE scare has produced a boom for organic farmers. Their beef costs up to 25% more, but they say customers are prepared to pay for peace of mind. The initial cost of calves adds up to around £250 per animal for conventional beef, £320 for organic. Food and land costs are £80 higher for organic cattle. So even if both farmers make the same profit of £70, the organically reared animal will have cost £150 more.
Ian Miller's 300 acres have been dedicated to organic farming for 6 years.
He was among the first to recognise that the biggest potential might lie in naturally reared animals rather than crops of organically grown vegetables. His cattle are now among the rarest in the world, grazing on land free of herbicides, pesticides and synthetic fertilisers, untouched by growth-producing hormones or animal feeds. Scientists monitor their development to see what lessons can be applied to the rearing of all United Kingdom cattle. For Farmer Miller, the struggle to produce additive-free food is one of principle, not profit.
If I was to go bust tomorrow, I'd have no regrets, because what we are doing down here is right. And if you're right, you're right, and you can never be wrong.
Just up the road at Perthshire Cattle Mart, a major venue for foreign buyers, there's growing support for a change to modern methods of beef production.
We use far too many chemicals. If we can get back to using farmyard manure as fertiliser instead of stuff out of bags, it's more economical, it produces better beef, there are less chemicals mixed up with it, and to me it seems a very sensible way to do things.
For shoppers, organic meat is still hard to find. Only a few supermarkets and butchers have it on their shelves. But customers seem ready to pay up to a third more.
They seem to want that item and are willing to pay the price for it.
The Miller's Farm has recently been appointed the European Centre for Organic Research. So while these British cattle fatten themselves up on this natural pasture, French farmers are helping to pay for every mouthful. Norman Rees, News at 10 in Perthshire.
Schools are having to fix their own budgets now, so a Nottingham school has found it needs to make 7 of its teachers redundant. A report next. Plus, is it dry enough this summer to start a real water grid? And the point about politics is picking up the beat. That's in a couple of minutes.
Sludge into the North Sea last year. Grilled or poached?
The Daily Express makes you think, doesn't it?
Heathrow to Paris and back 6 times a day. Now is a serious alternative.
What would your reaction be if we suggested you bank with Gyrobank? But at Gyrobank, you can set up an overdraft, discuss a loan, check your account by phone till 8 at night. You can draw money from any Link cash dispenser throughout the country. And you'll get a generous 9% interest on every pound in your Kiwi current account.
Yeah, seems like a good idea to me.
With Gyrobank, you'll have the last laugh.
Obviously, they've just heard about corn, the delicious new alternative to meat. Give it a try.
Wrong! 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 Right!
Ruff! 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 Ruff!
Right!
Teachers in some parts of the country were handed redundancy notices today as schools looked for ways to save money. Since April, head teachers and governors rather than local authorities have had charge of their schools' finances. Some are sacking staff to balance the books.
After 20 years in teaching, Brian Foyster received his redundancy notice today. He's one of seven teachers at this Nottinghamshire school who won't be there next term. No one had criticised his work, the school simply couldn't afford to keep him on.
It comes as quite a shock when you realise it's yourself, particularly when you've had quite a good experience in teaching and you've done lots of things and it seems such a waste of experience.
This maths and economics teacher was another casualty, even though his is a shortage subject.
It's a sad day for education, quite honestly, when you think about it. A lot of dedicated teachers are suddenly losing their jobs.
According to the teaching union, the NASUWT, Nottinghamshire is worst off with 217 job losses. Kent is losing about 200 teachers and Surrey 55, although most are voluntary redundancies.
Choosing a secondary school for your child? St George's School Birmingham has...
Controversially, some schools have now turned to advertising to attract more pupils. The worry is that the new budgets relate to the number of children, but not the actual salaries of teachers. The unions claim it means more experienced teachers are most likely to be made redundant. Some governors admit they're unhappy about the situation.
Well, it's a matter of meeting the budget for the school budget, and that's the only way we can do it, it seems.
Do you think it's an acceptable situation?
No, not really, no.
Head teachers meeting in Torquay today say the budgets are being set too low, making job losses inevitable.
I think it's quite obscene, quite frankly, that we are seeing teachers going, compulsorily or voluntarily, at a time when we are desperately short of teachers in various parts of the country.
Education ministers wouldn't comment on the job losses, but a department spokesman said the new system was fair. It had simply exposed the true costs of some schools.
A television drama documentary based on allegations that the Royal Ulster Constabulary operated a shoot-to-kill policy will not be shown in Northern Ireland. The two-part film called Shoot to Kill will be shown throughout the rest of the ITV network on Sunday and Monday. Today, Ulster Television said they'd received legal advice that broadcasting it in the province could be contempt of court. Inquests into the alleged Shoot to Kill cases have still to take place.
Tomorrow's edition of the Times newspaper claims the government used delaying tactics to avoid a European Community prosecution over the state of Blackpool Beach. It says the Department of the Environment feared it would affect the successful flotation of the water industry. The Times report is based on confidential government documents leaked to the environmental pressure group Friends of the Earth.
Blackpool Beach, one of Britain's most popular seaside holiday spots, has already attracted criticism from the European Commission. Sewage is sieved, then dumped below the low waterline on two of the town's beaches. It's failed European Commission clean water tests for the past 3 years. The EC is now prosecuting Britain for failing to meet cleanliness standards. But tomorrow's Times newspaper alleges the government sought to delay any prosecution until the water authorities had been privatised. In a confidential memo to the then Environment Minister William Waldegrave, officials said an agreement with the Commission must now be preferable to an action which would have wide-ranging national implications going well beyond Blackpool. But Mr. Waldegrave, the article goes on to say, was advised that beyond a provisional £35 million to clean up Blackpool, the government could get away with assurances without the need for significant additional expenditure. One environmental pressure group tonight accused the government of putting political expediency beyond safety.
The government has been ducking and weaving, trying to outwit the European Commission, instead of taking the action needed to bring bathing water up to standard. It was obviously concerned about the implications for water privatisation, not environmental protection.
The allegations are likely to embarrass Environment Secretary Chris Patten, who's already promised a vigorous defence of the government's pollution record in the wake of the European Commission prosecutions.
A group of scientists says eastern England will become a barren dust bowl unless something's done to improve water supplies there. The scientists say a national grid should be introduced to bring water from areas where there's a surplus to those where there's a drought.
Scientists warn a day like today in eastern England will be cool compared to what's coming with global warming. Massive increase in evaporation will make water scarce. The scientists say a national water grid is now needed to pump in fresh supplies from other regions. Otherwise, agricultural land will become desert and underground reservoirs supplying water to homes will simply dry up. The scientists say dry regions like the east of England could be helped by wetter areas in the west, such as Wales, where rainfall will increase. Water from there could be fed into the Severn, taken out lower down and pumped across the Cotswolds. From there it could be poured into the headwaters of the Thames and then distributed to drought-prone areas.
By 20 years' time, we've really got to get that water supply system in, and we've got to learn to live with the idea that we buy our water, we irrigate our lawns, and that water is a scarce and expensive commodity in eastern England.
Water companies say some water is transported, but moving it across country from Scottish and Welsh reservoirs is too impractical and costly. For as long as possible, they want to rely on local underground water supplies, brought up by many small pumping stations like this.
It's easily said that you can have a national grid. Water is very heavy, it takes a lot of pumping around. It's not quite as straightforward as people might imagine. And it will be preferable, if we can possibly manage it, to develop resources locally.
But scientists warn water companies they must act now and not wait for the full impact of global warming. Justin Jones, News at 10, Norfolk.
Israeli soldiers have shot and killed a Palestinian teenager and injured at least nine others in continued violence in the occupied territories.
Free of some of the toughest curfew restrictions ever, the Gaza Strip's Palestinians began to re-emerge, slowly. But they are still subjected to a nightly curfew. There are two ways inside, one with army escorts which antagonize the Palestinians. Soldiers are now under strict orders not to shoot, if possible, to hold down the casualty figures. This is the other side of Gaza, an unauthorized view, one the army doesn't show. A Palestinian family in the Shati refugee camp, grieving for 27-year-old Musa Hosuna, shot and killed in the recent protests. 800 people were wounded during the recent clashes with the army. Many are still in hospital, seeing their relatives for the first time. Doctors lost count of the numbers of plastic bullets they surgically removed. In 2.5 years, 8,000 casualties have been treated at this one hospital alone. Almost a third of them are under the age of 15.
We have seen children 4, 5, and 6 years with broken arms, broken legs, double pelvis fractures and such things. I couldn't believe it, and I still can't believe it.
Such vivid accounts of Israeli actions have been passed on to visiting UN relief officials in support of Palestinian claims for protection. Brent Sadler, News at 10, in the Gaza Strip.
Finally, the Prime Minister went to the Abbey Road recording studios today, much loved by the Beatles in their day, including one Mr. Ringo Starr. What then followed may not please him or Mr. Phil Collins, but Mrs. Thatcher, well, judge for yourself.
Very well.
Right.
And that's it tonight. Good night.
As if we have a rather unsettled weekend ahead. Well, the wind flow chart helps explain this, with the high pressure responsible for today's fine weather, but having drifted off down towards the Mediterranean. We'll deal with things there in a moment. The significant thing for us, though, is this low pressure bang on our doorsteps, set to bring rain to the north and the west tonight. That's the theme for tomorrow morning, with rain over Northern Ireland, most of Scotland, the west coast of Wales. Elsewhere, getting off to quite a reasonable start, though as the day goes on, some quite heavy showers are likely to develop, some of those thundery at times. As is the nature of showers, it's very much the luck of the draw. Some places will miss out completely, others will get a fair old drenching. The odd heavy shower might just crop up in Northern Ireland and in Scotland during the afternoon. Despite these showers, temperatures in the southeast quite reasonable, around 21. cooler and fresher elsewhere, 16 to 18, 61 to 64. Now, I thought we'd round things off by taking a look at Europe for the weekend, and it's the unsettled weather we had there over continental Europe. The Mediterranean, fine and sunny, perhaps the odd shower cropping up in Italy or Greece come the weekend. Temperatures in the Med at their best, sizzling into the 80s, cooler further north and further east. I leave you with tomorrow's sunset times and a soggy summary. Good night.
Good evening. There's been a breakdown in talks aimed at settling a strike at Heathrow, which pilots fear is threatening aircraft safety. 7,000 British Airways engineers are in dispute over rosters. Some of their work is now being done by managers. The British Airline Pilots Association say they're very concerned about safety and that the situation can't go on.
The indefinite strike is in protest at plans to introduce new working arrangements for engineers who maintain short-haul aircraft. British Airways want 8-hour shifts increased to 12 hours to better meet their operations at Heathrow's Terminal 1.
Our people don't want 12-hour shift working because they work on aircraft maintenance under stress in stressful conditions. They believe that 12-hour shift working is not conducive to safe working practices because of the tiredness factors that will creep in.
British Airways tonight hit back at claims safety standards were at risk because of the dispute. They say safety is the top priority and all aircraft are thoroughly checked before they fly. Meanwhile, the strikers will hold a mass meeting tomorrow morning to consider their next move.
Union leaders are warning that the end of the Cold War could leave the southeast facing thousands of job losses in the defence industry. It comes as 220 people lose their jobs at the Rakel factory in Wembley. The plant making military equipment is closing. The company blames a drop in orders on the thaw in east-west relations. Workers are stunned and the unions fear there's worse to come.
And everybody's shocked. They still can't believe it. We are going to be redundant, really.
I don't think I've still sunk in to people that not going to be coming here anymore.
Nearly 50% of defence expenditure in Great Britain is spent in the southeast. 400,000 workers in our region depend upon the defence industries for their livelihood. And unless employers and the government start planning now, we're going to see catastrophe in the 90s.
Armed police surrounded a college in Streatham this evening in the search for a security van robber. The raider got away with what's thought to be a substantial sum in a hold-up outside a post office on Streatham High Road. Officers searched Southwestern College after a student reported seeing the fugitive fleeing inside. Police are warning the public to stay clear of a drug smuggler who escaped from a prison coach after stabbing a guard. He's Brazilian Ronaldo Estrada, who was serving a 14-year sentence. The coach was in Old Street on its way from Wormwood Scrubs to Maidstone Prison when he pulled out a knife and slashed the guard on the hand. Tower Hamlets Council are going ahead with a High Court attempt to ground a new air ambulance operating from the London Hospital. They claim health managers have failed to give an undertaking to carry out noise insulation work on nearby houses. The council will tomorrow seek an injunction preventing the helicopter service starting on Monday. A £2.5 million mansion in Berkshire has gone up for sale after the pop group Five Star were forced to move out because they couldn't pay the mortgage. Five Star hit stardom with the album Luxury of Life while they were still living with their parents in Romford. But the luxury life ended when bailiffs and security guards came to repossess their new 13-bedroom home in Sunningdale. Two leading clerics let the train take the strain when they traced an ancient trail round the 96-mile boundary of the London diocese. The centuries-old tradition is known as beating the bounds. But instead of walking like their forefathers, the Bishop of Stepney and the Archdeacon of Northolt followed the route on the Docklands Light Railway. And the Thames weather, it'll be dry overnight with some mist patches and a low of 12 degrees Celsius. Tomorrow will start sunny and warm with temperatures climbing to 23 degrees, but the afternoon will see thundery showers. And that's all. There's more Thames news tomorrow morning at 5 to 10. Good night.
Coming next, digging deeper for Eurotunnel, DIY in difficulty, booming banking in Birmingham, and unique investment advice from the man who controlled £50 billion. Stay tuned.
Have you met the man yet?
Watch 01 when you can.
90 million. For you, sir.
On shampoo and conditioner? Take two bottles into the shower. Not me. I just want to wash my hair and go. So I use Vidal Sassoon Wash and Go. Salon shampoo plus complete conditioner in one bottle. Vidal Sassoon Wash and Go leaves my hair clean, fully conditioned, and looking terrific. Shampoo and conditioner? Not me. Now I just wash and go.
Salon shampoo and complete conditioner in one. Vidal Sassoon Wash and Go.
Cash flow, the lifeblood of business. But over a year, your cash flow can be erratic. Long-term borrowing and secured working capital will probably stay the same. But when funding requirements are higher, you may need to raise extra cash for up to 90 days. So consider Arrow Stock Financing, a simple way of raising up to £250,000 without encumbering your assets. For details, call 061-941-4444 or see the Arrow's advertisements in the financial press.
Your toothbrush is a lifetime quest to banish plaque from your teeth. Rinse with plaques before brushing, and it'll be stronger and more efficient, because plaques help shift plaque.
You only have one face, and it's important to look after it, I think.
We asked Annalise to wash her face with Olay's new foaming beauty wash for 5 days instead of soap.
After rinsing, my skin feels soft, not dry like soap can leave it.
Olay's moisturising fluids and a soap-free formula have been blended to create today's new face wash.
I noticed a difference after 5 days. Your face feels a lot fresher and cleaner and very smooth and not at all dry like I'd found that soap could leave it.
Switch to Olay's new foaming beauty wash.
I won't use soap again.
Jos kielesi on väittelyn kiemuroiden mutkistava, yrität tulla toimeen omiin nokkinesi.
Al, tu es là?
Je t'écoute.
J'ai le plaisir de t'annoncer que j'ai repris les marques sur le marché.
Oh, Butter, 你需要和那个 Mori 谈谈，我要拿回我的钱。
Eso es, encontraremos el saxofón místico. Igor, eres lo máximo.
You can read all about it in our annual report. Ring 081-847-7766 for your copy.
Six unarmed men killed in 1 month. Allegations of cover-ups by senior officers. The special branch operating as a force within a force, accountable to no one. The press and the public will not be satisfied unless there's a full independent inquiry.
We've got a little job for you.
If they're after a rubber stamping job, sir, you've come to the wrong man.